VR, and they do Science Friday. So they have their own Science Friday app. So they have both audio as well as video. So if I wanted to just do an audio one, so this specific Science Friday says, so far no silver bullet to stop lethal bat fungus. So if you did want to listen to it, you can.
Next up, a biological threat is sweeping across eastern North America from Nova Scotia to Ontario through the internet.
So let's say if you just want to try to keep students interested in current science articles and technology, you can just do a brief podcast. It puts them all in the same place. If you wanted to do a video podcast, it has this as well. And it works alongside the working today. But they do have video ones as well. So if you just want to try to keep current, for my Science Honor Society, sometimes we'll go through and just see what's been put up on Science Fridays, just to stay current. So that's a nice one. If you do talk about anything viral or bacterial, there's one called biomicrobes. And this is kind of a three-dimensional representation of different fungus, bacteria, and virus. And you can search for whichever one you want. So let's say if you want to see Bacillus anthracis. So we see several different models or several different images. You can go to each one. These images are really beautiful. So here's an SEM. We can see that it's rod-shaped. There's four mighty microbes. And it has just a lot of them. So let's say if you're talking about avian flu, if you want to see what avian flu looks like. So here's a TEM. But basically, any disease you want, it is there. This is pretty extensive. Okay.
Is there a list of all these on your input?
Oh, all the apps? Yeah. And I'll show you the input. So I'll show you the input code at the end. So don't feel like you have to write all this down. I have it in the presentation. So it'll be accessible to you. I don't want you guys to feel like you have to rush. I know that I'm probably talking pretty fast. So I'll show you guys. You probably use TED in your classroom. So TED's brilliant. Wanted to share a few that I use, a few talks that are particularly good. So there's one that's actually by Bill Gates. He does one on malaria, which is kind of a good segue, especially in AP. They're going to talk about changes in point mutations. There's one by Rob Dunbar. He works out at Stanford. He does one on climate change. Sylvia Earle actually won the TED Prize for ocean acidification. So I feel like if you have a topic that might be a little bit difficult to understand, the TED Talk is really where you go. Bonnie Bassler is brilliant. She actually does like form sensing of bacteria, and she does really good work. So if you take a look at that and kind of use it as a tool in your class to help try to explain concepts. There's one that somebody drew Gary, and he actually did real-time like 3D animation of actin filaments and how different molecules can actually move down them. And you can actually see the molecules look like they're walking. They're actually walking down. And I think to see it visually, to try to visualize the things that are almost invisible or difficult to conceptualize, is really good.
TED and the Lost Question.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Your own questions or?
Oh, I haven't tried the own questions, but that's great. Yeah, I know I've shown a few TED Ed, which is also definitely really good source. So there's one that's done by the Howard Hughes Medical Institute. So it has different topics, and within the topics it has built-in slides and built-in videos that are done by experts in their field. So if you wanted to talk about, let's choose something controversial, because I love talking about that. Right, the human and chimpanzee evolution. So you can go through, it has slides, it has imagery, and then you might get to a little icon where it says video, and then one of these experts is going to talk to you or talk to your class about their viewpoint. So the Howard Hughes Medical Institute, and they have a pretty good array of talks. They have stuff for earth science, geological history of oxygen, regulation of lactase. So they have a lot of stuff. So it's worth hearing. For the biology classroom, I like iCell. So iCell is 3D movable cells. So it has bacterial, plant, and animal. So let's say if I went and made an animal cell. So here's our animal cell that I can modify. Let's see if I want to, so it's also differentiated for different learners. So you have basic, intermediate, advanced. So let's say if you just have a basic standard biology course, you can click on something. So here's our ER, age in the transport of proteins, right? If we went to the advanced, now I can read a lot more about what the ER does. It's a primary site of protein translation for eukaryotes. It connects the nuclear membrane to smooth nerve sections. So this can really be useful in terms of that. You can click on basically anything that you want. So there's our Golgi. You can go back and compare that to a plant cell. What's in our plant cell? Or class. So I think sometimes just seeing cells a little bit more three-dimensionally is more interesting. In terms of general classroom use, there is something called Penzu. Penzu is, it's really meant to be online journaling, but what I've done in the past is, let's say if I have a bell ringer, let's choose a day. So here's just a day. So I'll put some questions on the board. So what is the origins of all of the people who have answered before? So you can ask them questions at the beginning, you can answer as a group. Penzu links online. So all of your journals, so here I have an earth science journal, biology journal, I guess they set up one for me. But all these journals can be accessible to your students. So let's say instead of necessarily giving them a study guide, you can have all these questions and answers which they can do on their own, and that can serve as their study guide or later review about what we discussed in class. So I do like to do it, I recommend it. Alright, I don't know how many of you have seen BrainPop. Some of you have seen BrainPop. So you actually have to have a subscription to see everything that's on there. I'm not big at any of the names. There are a few free ones. So if you go under science free movies, they have one on cells, they have one on Mars, and Jane Goodall. So if you click on it, it'll show you a brief movie. And then there's always a quiz at the end that the kids would do.
Hey, that name, one of those 8x2 pieces. No, 8x2.
Okay, I won't say this little thing. They're very personable, and I think the kids like really to them. They're not some stodgy old professor trying to talk to them. They're just words
that are talking about. So, yeah. It has a lot of extra rooms and activities with everything.
Oh, good. Yeah, absolutely. So, let's say if you teach chemistry, here's an app called GoReact. So GoReact is nice because you drag and drop elements and it'll show you what the reaction is. And if you get it wrong, it'll give you a hint as to what element would probably interact with it a little bit better. So let's drag some elements down. So let's do, I'm going to drag down sodium. So it'll tell me a little bit about sodium, an alkali metal, tends to ionize or gain electric charge. And then it says, I'm going to add, So chlorine is extremely reactive. Now there's our element or our compound. Here's our sodium chloride. So you can kind of go through and just make these different combinations and try to have it be a little bit more interactive for learners from classroom. If you're talking about neurology, here's one called 3D brain. I cannot wish to upgrade. Okay. So again, this is movable. I'll show you different parts. So you can go under structures and you can search for any structure that you want. So let's say if you want to look at the frontal lobe. Alright, there we go. So I'll highlight it for you. If you want info, you can pull up the info about what's happening. I believe this is a free app as well, so if you'd like for your students to have it and interact with it, that's a pretty good tool. You can add labels, so it'll show you where it's at. And it'll also show you some case studies about some real world examples about what's happening to the brain. So that is 3D brain. We also have central skeleton. So if you teach anatomy or physiology, this is a really nice tool. So again, here's our skeleton. Skeleton is movement, whichever orientation. So there's a lot of things that we can do. So let's say if you want to, so you can look for anything in particular. Let's say you want to look at the cervical spine. If you want to look at the skull, so you click on it and it's going to give you a close-up view. If you are a teacher and you have this up and you want to have a discussion, you just add the arrows. So look at that big noggin. If you are an eraser when you're done, there are built-in quizzes. So let's say if you want, you can turn my camera on or off. So it'll do a little drag and drop. So we have to decide which part of this highlight is that you want to drop it to you. You just try. It's not available. But the kids can kind of do this sort of game. So I do like essential skeleton as well.
Okay. What's the name of this app?
Essential skeleton.
So how did you find these to come to you? Accept these as part of your
You know, a lot of this, I actually have to give credit to Mr. Haley. So he'll send me emails and say, hey, have you checked out the latest iPad apps that are out there for science? So I'm like, sure, let me try it out. So these are the ones that I've liked. So I think so many apps are coming out so recently, it's kind of hard to keep up. But as soon as I get the update of some new apps that are out, I'll try it out. So if you teach astronomy or anything else about earth science, we have one called Solar Walk. Solar Walk is really very beautiful. So it does movies. I think if you have a plan for it, it'll do a movie for you. So there is a whole lot of these videos. put them into all, there's 192 stories. That's what they said. So basically, I like to use it for temperature change, for ice melts, water cycle, but you can just see whatever you want, carbon dioxide levels, carbon monoxide levels. They have a lot about out in the solar system. So that's also a really good tool. Okay, so I also promised to talk about Showbie. So let me make sure one other factoid. So I have a website, the link is on my Evernote. If you're looking for just general activities about what to do in a biology or earth science classroom, I have an entire year list on my website. It's free and available to whoever wants to use it. Feel free to adapt, modify, whatever you want to do. So if you're going into earth science, I'm going to use the brand for 3 weeks. So I have amazing guided syllabus. I do weekly articles. So instead of reading the textbook, I read from primary and secondary sources. So if you guys want any of this, feel free to use it. I've got chapter notes, I've got labs, and personal notes. So it's all up there, so feel free to use that. If you're just looking for something that's not necessarily an app, you just want an activity, I have a lot of activities. All right, so let me go back to my, So you can also have voice notes.
Libby, I think that your graphs look great. All right, keep up the good work. Lydia.
So if you want to add voice feedback, you can. If you want to add text feedback, you can. So I know that the foreign language department really likes this program because the students can just submit a voice note and then the teacher can submit a voice note back. And I think you're limited to like 5 minutes. But really talking for longer than 5 minutes in an introductory French class, I doubt they're going to do that anyway. So it's especially good for foreign language, but it could also be good for other reasons. Let me go back to the keynote. Let me show you some figures. Okay, so I just asked them, what do you like better for you an assignment, Showbie or iPad? And they're kind of neck and neck. They said Showbie a little bit, but they also kind of like iPad as well. So they're kind of either or. So with Edmodo, things get posted in a newsfeed. And if you posted it a week ago, it's a little bit hard to find it sometimes. Whereas on Showbie, it's just on the left-hand side. So that's one plus. What do you like better for submitting work? And a lot of people like Showbie better. So it's really much more streamlined. It's a lot more simple. You don't have these multiple avenues. The kids were a little bit sad when I went to edit, but we need the school to be conscious. And then I said, what app do you like better overall? And so it was just kind of a mix, should be one a little bit. But let's talk about some pros and cons. So now that I use both, so what are some pros about it? So you can have class conversations. So that's great. So if the kids want to post things to other kids, they can. If they want to ask you or if they reply, you can. You can do polls and quizzes. So I've done polls and quizzes through Edmodo. They sometimes freeze. So they're not 100%. It's really easy grading on the iPad. A pro could be multiple feedback options. Having multiple avenues for submission can be good if that's what people would rather do through Dropbox or some other format, that can be fine. The other thing I like about it is you can find when something's sent out. So on Showbie, as soon as you post something, it's posted. But on another, you can say post this in a week, and it'll show up a week later. So that's pretty helpful. Alright, so what are some cons they see about it? So the app for students is still not fully functional. So sometimes they also have to go to the online version of Edmodo to actually download stuff because the app's not really like a regular stuff. Sometimes it uses freeze. There's multiple steps in order to submit the document. So it's not kind of a one and done. You kind of have to, I'm sure some of the kids can tell you a lot better than I can because they do it every day. But there's multiple steps in order to do it. And then you have to scroll through to find documents. Alright, so what are some pros about Showbie? So you can add voice responses and you can text to those who need work. You can annotate the document on the student side and teacher side. It has a streamlined submission process, easy to find assignments. So what are some cons I found? So the ability, well, pin notes has actually gone up. But originally they promised you could text in the document, so basically you could bypass GoodReader. So instead of the kids having their GoodReader, you just do it all through Showbie. It's all done in-house. Because GoodReader can be a little bit overwhelming, especially for the younger children, I think. So, and they promised that you could add text, but I keep asking them when that's going to happen. It hasn't happened yet. And I think until you can like type on it, it's not the best yet.
Do you have Showbie as a website too?
Absolutely. You just go to Showbie.com. I think it's called the Paperless Classroom Made Simple is like the motto. And it really is very simple. So that's a plus. On the downside, you can't do a whole lot else with it. It's really just work in, work out.
So there's just more writing on the website on the computer with Edmodo. It has more features for it. You can do
absolutely
files highlighting and texting and just marking.
Absolutely. Yeah, I know like when you grade from Edmodo to the iPad, I don't think you can annotate that way, but if you do the online version, you can.
As well. Yeah. You can only type response. You can mark.
So, I mean, we're very pro Edmodo, and I feel like if you're in high school, Edmodo is the way to go. I just wanted to put out there a possible alternative, especially if there are younger grades, that it's something that could be a little bit more simple.
there's another one out called Schoology, and returns that. And that's a free version that works fine, and then you can upgrade to a paid version that will also impact PowerScore.
Amazing. Okay. Yeah, I'm not sure.